Well, where will you be this New Year's Eve when the clock strikes midnight? And I'm not talking about physically. It's not some magical time where your goals are reset. All the goals that you failed to achieve in 2019. It's not a magical reset of all the relationships that might have been broken during 2019. A lot of people treat it that way, though, right? They make these New Year's resolutions. They're going to improve on their last year. They're making these promises to themselves that they most likely will not keep. And I was looking through New Year's resolutions, and the most complete 10 New Year's resolutions I could find were from 2018. This is the most common, 10 most common New Year's resolutions. And I'm not sure they're in any kind of order, but I'll give them to you here. It says, get your photo taken in 5 interesting places. Now, I'm not sure about that one because, I mean, you could like take a picture next to a storm drain. That could be interesting, right? So I'm not sure exactly how that works. But the number 2, learn a party trick. You might hear know any good party tricks. Yeah. And number 3, break a record. Now, this one I looked into a little bit. They're not talking about just any old record. They're saying break a Guinness Book of World Record. So that's a challenging one. Make a new friend a month. I like this one. This is a good one. Make a new friend. Meet someone new every month and make a friend. Develop a good relationship with your body. I guess that means just taking care of your body. That's a weird way of saying that, but learn something you wish you had learned as a child. I myself, it was really emphasized yesterday with all the ice. I never learned how to skate with hockey skates. You know, I know I live in Minnesota now, but I grew up in the South, and where guys learned how to skate with figure skates. That's just what you were given too. So you had the toe picks, and that's the only way I know how to move forward on skates is with the toe pick. And so, seeing videos of people skating out on the streets yesterday, I was like, oh, I wish I could skate on the ice skates, but I just can't. And it's tough because my son, he wants to play hockey with his friends, and I can't teach him how to skate. And it's such a hard thing because I don't know how to tell him this is how you need to do it. And so that'd be something I'd go back and do. Try a new food each week. That sounds entertaining, actually. I could do that one. Make the usual unusual. Kind of that whole, you're in a rut. You do everything the same every week, right? Try to do something different. So the usual is unusual. Sort out a financial worry. And then number 10, the last one on this list, is actually a really good one. Do something nice for others every day. Every day. Not once a week, every day. But I want to give you an alternative to that, an alternative list of resolutions. And that's in Ephesians 4, 31 through 32. It says, get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. That's a pretty good resolution right there, right? That'd be a good one to try to do every day. So it's a new day, right? We hit that new year, and it feels like a brand new day, and we can reset things. But you have to look back at your 2019 or the past, just looking backwards. And you may have had decisions in your life that maybe you fell for temptation in 2019 and it just kind of messed some things up for you. Or you had some struggles, some storms in life in the last year. And you just don't know how you're going to go into the new year and adjust and be happy about it. And so I want to give you some examples, some biblical examples of people who kind of went through some similar things that we go through and how they get through it and how what it looks like on the other side on that next day, on the first day of the new year. And the first person I'm going to talk about is David. And we talked about this week. David is my favorite Bible character. We learned that at the men's casual night. It was a question I asked in a part of a game. And so I love David. David's such a rich character in the Bible, and he goes the gambit of everything from being in the child shepherd fighting lions and things like that to defeating Goliath to all of the psalms that he wrote. It's just an amazing person. And So I'm going to be reading actually out of 2 Samuel 11, and we'll be reading from 1 through 17 and then 26 through 27. Now this won't be up on the screen because it's a little bit lengthy, but I'm going to go ahead and read that here. And it says, "In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole Israelite army. They destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. But David remained in Jerusalem. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, 'She is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite.' Then David sent the messenger, sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. Now she was purifying herself from her monthly uncleanliness. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David saying, 'I am pregnant.' So David sent this word to Joab, 'Send me Uriah the Hittite,' and Joab sent him to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked him how Joab was, how the soldiers were, and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, 'Go down to your house and wash your feet.' So Uriah left the palace, and a gift from the king was sent after him. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the palace with all his master's servants and did not go down to his house. David was told Uriah did not go home. So he asked Uriah, 'Haven't you just come from a military campaign? Why didn't you go home?' Uriah said to David, 'The ark and Israel and Judah are staying in tents, and my commander Joab and my lord's men are camped in the open country. How could I go to my house to eat and drink and make love to my wife? As surely as you live, I will not do such a thing.' Then David said to him, 'Stay here one more day, and tomorrow I will send you back.' So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next. At David's invitation, he ate and drank with him, and David made him drunk. But in the evening, Uriah went out to sleep on his mat among his master's servants. He did not go home. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it to Uriah. In it he wrote, 'Put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest. Then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die.' So while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah at a place where he knew the strongest defenders were. When the men of the city came out and fought against Joab, some of the men in David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite died." Then we move to verse 26. It says, "When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done, this pleased the Lord." Now, that was a lengthy one. But there was a lot of things in there that David did wrong. A lot. He sinned multiple times. And David wasn't one, we have in the history of the Bible, he wasn't one making a lot of bad errors. But this one was pretty bad. And he made several at one time. And when he found out, when he really felt it in his heart, when Nathan came to him and talked to him about what he had done, he could have been posturing and he could have said, "Well, you know, I'm the king, I can do whatever I want." He didn't. He repented of what he said from that. And in 2 Samuel 12, 13, he said, "Then David said to Nathan, 'I have sinned against the Lord.'" He knew what he had done is wrong. And he knew he deserved death based on God's law. But God spared him. Instead, the son that was born died. But David, he could have been distraught for the rest of his existence because of that moment, because of that sin that he committed, the awful sins that he had done. He killed a man after committing adultery with the man's wife and getting her pregnant. He could have been distraught and been worthless. But instead, he devoted himself back to God, turned himself around, and got back on board with what God had wanted for the Israelites. He was the apple of God's eye. Psalm 17:8 says, "Keep me as the apple of your eye." This man here that killed somebody, he was the apple of God's eye and wrote most of the book of Psalm. How we handle what we do in the past affects what we handle the next day. But maybe it's not sin in your life, like David, that you have in your past. Maybe it's storms in your life. Maybe it's a death of a loved one, or a loss of a job, or just personal health issues that you've been experiencing. Now, there's lots of examples of that in the Bible. The Bible's filled with stories of loss of someone or something. But I want to talk to you about one specific person that really covers all the bases. And you probably know who I'm going to talk about. But his name is Job. Job, you almost feel bad for the guy. But you know the end of the story, and so you don't. But it's the story of Job starts off in Job 1:1. And it says, "In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil." Then we go to Job 1:13 through 19. Now this is going to go into what he has to experience. And let me know if someone has experienced all these things. So we can get through this here. "One day when Job's son and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, 'The oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing nearby. The Sabians attacked and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell you.'" That's rough, right? Losing all your donkeys and oxen. "Well, while he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, 'Hey, the fire of God fell from the heavens and burned up the sheep and the servants, and I'm the only one who escaped to tell you.'" Okay, that's pretty bad too, right? So two things going bad. That's rough. "While he was still speaking, another messenger came in." I mean, can you imagine, can you see this? Like, messengers just keep, like, next one comes in, like, now what's going on? "And the Chaldeans formed three raiding parties and swept down on your camels and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I'm the only one who escaped to tell you." So pretty much his fortune is wiped out. I mean, back then, livestock and your farming, that was how you made money. And with all that gone, he was basically poor. He had nothing. He has no way to provide for his family. "But even then, while he was still speaking, yet another messenger came and said, 'Your sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the older brother's house, when suddenly a mighty wind swept in from the desert and struck the four corners of the house. It collapsed on them, and they are dead, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell you.'" Now, that's pretty rough. All this is happening in a short period of time. And he's getting all this bad news. And he's thinking, "Oh, I lost all my wealth," and then he loses all his kids. That is a very, very difficult thing to hear. Then in Job 2:7, "So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head." So now, not only has he lost his wealth, he's lost his family, and now he's covered in sores that were extremely painful from what the Bible says. And not only that, his wife starts to question everything he's doing, in questioning God and saying, "You should just give up and die." But what does Job do in this situation that we can look to for strength? And after, if you read through Job, it's very entertaining, because he's going back and forth with his friends who are telling him to basically give up on God. In Job 42:1-6, it says, "Then Job replied to the Lord, 'I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, Who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things that did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, "Listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me. My ears have heard you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes.'" Even through all this, Job was faithful to God at the end. When we have bad things in life, a lot of times people push God away and blame God for the bad things that happen in life. Countless times I hear of act of God, right? The insurance, that someone died from an act of God, or the house was destroyed from an act of God. Just because it's bad weather. And that's not doing God justice, I don't think. In Job 42:12-17, it says this, "The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Kezia, and the third Karen Hapuch. Nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughter, and their father granted them inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation. And so Job died an old man and full of years. Now, I'm not teaching the prosperity gospel, like if you follow God or whatever, you're going to be rich and have blessings like that. But what I am teaching is that with a new day, we have a hope in Christ where we don't have to worry about the troubles from yesterday. It doesn't mean that troubles aren't going to happen again coming up in front of you. It just means you don't have to worry about them because our God is more powerful than anything here. Amen. One of the last things, maybe the sinful life, maybe you turned your back on God for some reason. And you wonder what can happen in this new year. What happens the day after turning your back on the Savior? And we have an example of that on the day of Pentecost in Acts 2:22-24. It says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him. As you yourself know, this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him." And in Acts 2:36-39, it says how we go through the new day. After we turn our backs on Christ. "Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, what shall we do?' Peter replied, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call.'" And what was the response? There's yesterday, there was today, and then tomorrow. Acts 2:41 says, "Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day." Though there will be problems and issues that will arise and seem to be overwhelming at times, if we live in Christ, then that slate is clean for us. If we accept and repent from what we were doing and who we were yesterday, then today and tomorrow and moving forward in Christ, we will be cleansed. And we don't have to worry. And it doesn't matter what situations you've faced. It doesn't matter the troubles that you believe to be around the corner. God is bigger and better than anything you can imagine here on this earth. And 2020, is going to be a great year because God and Jesus are our King. That's who we serve. We serve something better and greater than anything here on this earth. So any type of political situation, any type of health situation, any type of whatever could happen, job situation, 2020 is going to be great because we serve our God.
Amen.
Now, I want to give you a New Year's resolution for 2020. A better one than the first one. A Christ-based one. And you might recognize some of these words because, to be honest, I'm a big For King and Country fan. Love them. And a lot of these are from their songs because they're so on point with things. Burn the ships. Whatever happened yesterday, let it go. Walk away from it. Live in Christ this day and the next day and going forward. Don't let it hold you down. Don't let it weigh you down as you go forward. Don't let it keep you from where you need to go. Number two, love like you're not scared. How hard is it to love people sometimes on this earth because you're so scared of how they're going to treat you back or if you're going to get loved back? But don't love like that. Love people unconditionally like Christ loves us. Share that love with people. Give when it's not fair. As humans, we tend to do this, right? You're not going to get anything out of doing what you're going to do. So don't do it, right? But give. Give to people that need it. Live your life for another. Choose joy this year. Don't be down. Choose joy. There's a lot of things that can be negative in life that can keep you from having joy in your life. Don't let it. Through Christ, live that joy. Take time for a brother or sister in Christ this year. Set some time aside to go and be with a brother and sister. Fight for those that are weaker than you. And I'm talking about those that are maybe newer Christians. Help them. Help those that are in need for getting stronger in Christ. Speak out for freedom for Christianity. There's a lot of our Christian freedoms that are being pushed on in this world today. Don't let it be pushed down. Fight for those freedoms so that people can know Christ. And it's not just here in America, in the whole world. Christians are daily persecuted for believing that Jesus is our Savior. Stand tall in the face of temptation. It's a tough one. We all fall for temptation. We're not perfect. But if we have Jesus as the head of us, we can fight it. We can get through it. If you falter, you step through the next day cleansed by Christ if you're a Christian. And you just don't let it hold you down. Stand up to it. And the final one, the final resolution, I think is the key to all of this, is fix your eyes on Jesus. Keep your eyes on Jesus this year, and it's going to be an amazing year for you. Amen. Keep it off yourself. Keep it off the world. Keep it on Jesus. And it doesn't matter what happens around you. If your eyes are on Jesus, it doesn't matter what waves are crashing into you, you will stay above it, and you will be with Jesus. Now I'm going to pray real quick, and I'm going to ask the team to come up, and we're going to sing one more song. And if you need to pray about something, resolutions in your life that you need help with this going forward in 2020, please feel free to come up, and we'll pray for you. And but I just want you to know that 2020 is going to be a great year for Northlakes. 2020 is going to be a great year for North St. Paul. 2020 is going to be a great year for Christ. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this opportunity to speak for you and this time that we get to hear that we don't have to worry about our past. We don't have to worry about yesterday or even the last second behind us because we are moving forward in you and that you are our captain of our ship and you are guiding us where we need to go and we don't need to worry about it. We don't need to worry about the troubles that lie ahead because you are in charge of us. Please let us let go and let you be in charge of our lives so that we can glorify you. And in Jesus' name, amen.